Hey, how's it going, guys? It's Nate here, and welcome back to the smoky, smoldering world of Fallout 4. It's been quite a while since we've done one of these videos. Not necessarily a Fallout 4 video, or a 10 Tiny Details video for that matter, but it's been quite a few months since our last 10 Tiny Details in Fallout 4 video, which is basically a crime at this point. I mean, the wasteland of post-atomic Boston is absolutely riddled with a seemingly endless abundance of Easter eggs, hidden secrets, and incredible references sure to impress even the most dedicated of players. So today we'll be celebrating that fact yet again, as we dive right into our 10th edition of 10 Tiny Details You May Still Have Missed in Fallout 4. Starting off, Libertalia is a small raider settlement located just off the coast of the Nahant Wharf. Uniquely, it's located in the sea, comprised entirely out of various boats and other floating structures. This makes the Libertalia both a sort of iconic location and also a bit of an interesting challenge when attempting to clear. It was originally founded by a small group of ex-Minutemen following the destruction of the organization a few years back. The refugees initially tried to be respectful, good people. However, faced with the hardships of the Commonwealth, they slowly descended into lives of banditry and crime. Now, they're indistinguishable from any other Commonwealth ne'er-do-wells. Well, funnily enough, it seems that Fallout 4's Libertalia is a bit of a nod to a real-world, though likely fictitious, pirate utopia of the same name. According to legend, in the 17th century, pirate captain James Mission founded a pirate colony off the coast of Madagascar that he named Libertalia, and it was designed as a place where men and women of all faiths, backgrounds, and nationalities could live in peace, free from the various monarchs and empires governing the world at the time. Libertalia was described extensively in the 1724 book, A General History of Pirates, where the idea of it gained popularity, and it's since been mentioned in various other novels, plays, and even movies like Pirates of the Caribbean. Heck, it's a place in Assassin's Creed Black Flag. The general consensus is that Libertalia never actually existed, and no such settlement has ever been discovered despite multiple attempts. However, it's nice to know that Bethesda's keeping the idea still alive. Next on our list, we're setting sail for the island of Far Harbor, where we can find an interesting little New Vegas reference. We've talked a bit about this corporate competition before, but for those of you who don't know, Far Harbor hosts the headquarters of a small, local soda company known as Vim. Vim is a pretty popular drink on the island, or at least it was, and indeed, it was the most popular soda throughout the entire state of Maine back before the bombs fell. This put them in the crosshairs of Nuka-Cola, the big corporate giant that dominated the global pop market. And throughout various terminals located at the Vim headquarters, we can read about their interesting battle with the Nuka-Cola company. Well, one of the drinks Vim began producing just before the Great War was a special flavor that they called Vim Quartz. And indeed, we can still find a few bottles throughout the island. Now, for players who don't know, way back in Fallout New Vegas, we can find a beverage called Nuka-Cola Quartz. Nuka-Cola Quartz, according to the lore, was a version of the Nuka-Cola recipe that saw a limited release in the American Southwest, and was particularly ridiculed for the huge amounts of sugar contained in the drink. Hilariously, the terminals in the Vim plant reference the fact that their drink shares a name with one of Nuka-Cola's. And evidently that sparked a humongous legal battle for the quartz name, and Nuka-Cola won out, forcing Vim to agree to take their sodas off shelves within the next physical year. Of course, nuclear war would begin before Vim could ever honor their obligation. But still, a neat little nod to the Mojave by Bethesda. Coming in at number 3, Eddie Winter was a notorious crime boss back when Boston was still, well, Boston in 2077. He lorded over a vast criminal syndicate, and was able to successfully avoid justice. Rumor has it that just prior to the Great War, Winter was able to transform himself into a ghoul, and take refuge in a bunker, where he may still be alive to this very day. Nick Valentine's companion quest will see a search for Winter's secret hideout, and finally, once and for all 200 years later, put an end to his evil. Alas, Eddie Winter is likely based off of a real-world person. specifically Thomas Howard Winter, who led Boston's Winter's Hill Gang back in the 60s. Unlike Eddie Winter, Thomas, though, wasn't able to evade the jaws of justice for very long, and found himself in a federal prison after refusing to rat out any of his colleagues. But it's interesting to note that this iconic Fallout 4 side villain has some realistic roots. For fourth spot, one of Fallout 4's classic paintings that commonly can be seen in various places across the wasteland, as well as even crafted in settlement mode, depicts an adorable kitten playing with a toy rocket ship before a blue background. It's an easily recognizable picture, and certainly contrasts the tremendously grim nature of a place like this. Well, something you may not have known is that this cat is real. Well, sort of. You see, it's based off of Boomer, Nate Perkypile, Bethesda's lead artist's own pet kitty, as he revealed in a recent tweet. The more you know! Halfway through at number 5, it's off to Nuka World. Specifically, to be focusing in on one of the DLC's most fascinating characters, Seto. Seto was the son of two scavengers in the park, who died when he was barely an infant, victims of a horrifying super mutant raid. But rather miraculously, Seto survived. He was found by a pack of gorillas in the park's Safari Adventure region, who took him in and raised the boy as one of their own. Now, decades later, Seto's basically an incredibly strong gorilla man, and he'll request, using some very broken English and sign language, because you know, raised by monkeys, our assistance in ridding his home of a recent gator claw infestation. Now, you've probably already noticed some very obvious similarities between this Seto character and Tarzan, a fellow fictitious man also raised by primates. Copyrights to this character are also owned by Disney, so I can't show any footage. But I think we're all familiar with him. Well, it seems these clear parallels weren't lost on Bethesda either, and they included a couple of subtle Easter eggs referencing the Disney hit. The one I'd like to focus on comes from a note we can find near Seto's old home, written by his mother just moments before she passed away. In it, the woman begged someone to take good care of her son, knowing she was about to succumb to her injuries. And the note ends with the quote, "Tell our little Seto that his parents love him, and that if he's looking for us, we'll always be in his heart." End quote. This is seemingly a nod to the "You'll Be in My Heart" song by Phil Collins, written and composed for the original Tarzan movie. So, it would seem at least a few of the minds behind the Nuka World DLC were fans of animation movies back in their day. Sixth, within the Boston Common, players can find a bar simply called The Prost. To the untrained eye, this place looks totally insignificant. There's not much to do here, very little is offered in the way of loot, and it's not especially relevant to any of Fallout 4's major quests. However, 80s kids, which I'm sure are a huge demographic on this channel, may know better. You see, this place is a one-for-one replica of the Cheers bar from the 80s and early 90s sitcom named after it. Cheers! The TV show followed the tale of a group of friends, family, and customers who owned and frequented a bar called Cheers. And this Prost place looks exactly like the set. Heck, some of the skeletons inside are almost certainly based on some of the show's characters. Furthermore, if the link isn't already clear enough, the word Prost, when translated from German, literally means cheers. There's not much more to add about this. I guess Bethesda does have quite a few older employees. Next, within Diamond City, on the outskirts of the settlement towards the bleachers in the southern side, players can find a number of chairs. And carved into the backs of one of them is the word Spivvy. This is a reference to Junior Spivvy, a former second baseman who played for the Boston Red Sox up until 2008. Diamond City is of course based on the real-world Boston Red Sox's home stadium of Fenway Park. So the inclusion here makes quite a bit of sense, especially when you consider that many of Bethesda's own staff are actual Boston natives, who likely have a bit of fondness for the team. So much so that apparently not even a nuclear winter could allow them to forget about their favorite players. Coming in at number 8, we're heading back on over to the wonderful amusement park of Nuka World. Specifically, the Kitty Kingdom region of the complex. where, within the central funhouse, we can eventually find ourselves on a strange, spinning merry-go-round-like device. When on this contraption, we'll be able to enter through our pick of a number of red doors, most of which lead to dead ends or really weird scenes, with only one allowing us to progress further into the funhouse. However, behind one red door will be a really fascinating image, so to speak. Open it, and you'll find a mannequin wielding a knife standing before a skeleton in a terrified pose in a shower of all places. While a terrifying sight, anyone with a vague interest in horror movies likely immediately recognizes this as an Easter egg, referencing Alfred Hitchcock's 1960 classic, Psycho. Particularly, an especially famous scene in the film, wherein the killer storms a victim while she's in the shower. I'd play the clip, but, you know, copyright. And unfortunately, Alfred Hitchcock's old publicists won't respond to my emails. Moving on. Getting close to the end here at number 9, we're remaining in Nuka World, but leaving Kitty Kingdom, instead heading on out to Dry Rock Gulch, an American Old West-inspired section of the park. Here, running right through the middle of it, is the remains of what was once a giant and mighty roller coaster. It seems relatively insignificant now and doesn't pose much interest, but if the player is able to walk to the highest peak of the coaster, and by walk I also mean jetpack, you'll find something interesting. A tiny toy sloth can be discovered hanging onto a tree branch all the way up here. How adorable. And finally, last on our list, the Prydwen is the Brotherhood of Steel's principal airship. A gigantic structure that allegedly took well over a decade to construct, it is a mighty testament to the Brotherhood's power. Well, its name, Prydwen, seems to be a bit of an allusion to the legend of King Arthur. Specifically, King Arthur's ship, which was said to be called, you guessed it, the Prydwen. This reference is even more alarming when you consider that the Brotherhood of Steel's leader at the time is Elder Arthur Maxon. So, just as the legends say that thousands of years ago, King Arthur sailed through the English Channel on his Prydwen longboat, our modern King Arthur sails through the skies on his Prydwen airship. And with that, we are going to wrap up our 10th installment of 10 Tiny Details You May Have Missed in Fallout 4. Thanks for stopping by, everybody. Which of these Easter eggs, hidden secrets, or intriguing references caught your attention the most? And what fun facts in this wild wasteland have I yet to cover? Leave a comment down below. As always, like ratings are very much appreciated. Again, thanks for watching, and I hope to catch you all in my next video. Peace out, everyone.